when you look at this, which towel do you think was folded first? Yeah, most people would say that the brown towel was folded first and then the red one on top of that. That just kind of makes sense because the brown one's at the bottom. And we're going to do the same idea, the same thing when we're looking at rocks. We're going to determine what happened first, what happened second. If you take a look at these beautiful rocks here, we can tell that because they're layered, we know we've got some sedimentary rocks. I've got one rock layer that is the labeled A, that's this layer that we see right there, and I've got another rock layer labeled B, that's this rock layer up here. When we take a look at those rocks, which rock layer do you think happened first? Which one was deposited first? Well, you would probably say A, and that makes sense that A was deposited first. A is below B. That's the one that's going to happen first. The same thing that happened with our towels. How about this one right here? Light colored layer that we see down towards the bottom. Which one was deposited first? It was going to be layer B. Layer B was deposited first because we see it at the bottom. So we can tell by looking at some rock layers what happened, the order of events or the age of those rocks relative from one to another. And that's going to be our first focus of section number four. So here's our geology topics that we've studied so far: rocks and minerals, surface processes, dynamic crust is now done. And now we're going to move on to section four, Earth's history, before we move on to mapping. And in Earth's history, we're going to focus our attention right now on relative age dating. Not relative age dating as in you're going out with your uncle or something like that. Relative meaning one thing compared to another, and age dating determining how old something is. Not determining how old something is as in how many years old something is, but figuring out how old something is relative or compared to something else. You just told me that a certain rock was older than another. We know that rock layer B is older than rock layer A. We don't know how old rock layer B is. We don't know how old rock layer A is. We just know their relative ages. So that's going to be our focus, is just on their relative age dating. If we take a look at our page and our notes, we're going to focus on relative age dating. You notice we've got a handful of diagrams, and we've got three sections that we're going to look at on this page. This is page 61 of your notes. The first section that I want to focus on deals with this diagram on the top right. If we take a look again at these rock layers, you guys were able to figure out that the oldest rock layer, the rock layer that was deposited first. Remember, if something is older, it happened first. This would be rock layer C is the oldest rock layer. A would be the youngest rock layer. And that's that first rule or first principle that I like to talk about, is the principle of superposition. So the principle of superposition just simply says that the layer at the bottom is the oldest layer. If we take a look at the diagram, we've got layers A, B, C, and D. A is at the bottom of those layers. And just like the towels, unless that whole area was flipped and overturned or flipped upside down, which is not likely, the oldest rock layer is going to be at the bottom. So layer A is the oldest layer. Where layer D is the youngest layer. We can see that here with these rock layers. We know that the oldest rock layers would be down towards the bottom. And they're going to get younger and younger as we move up towards the top when we find the younger rock layers. We see the same thing is true with these rock layers here. The oldest rock layers at the bottom, the youngest rock layers are at the top. The rock layers at the bottom were deposited first, the rock layers at the top deposited after that. So relative age dating is going to be able to tell us the relative age. Now, we don't know how old those rock layers are. We don't know when they were deposited, but we can compare one rock layer to another rock layer to figure out how old they are. So that's relative age dating using the principle of superposition. So one rock layers are always deposited, nice horizontal layers, but they don't always stay that way. So we can see here we have these beautiful sedimentary rocks. They're in layers, so we know we've got sedimentary rocks, but something's happened to these sedimentary rocks. Notice how we could see these layers have been bent and folded. They were originally deposited horizontally, but something's happened to these layers over time. they start in nice horizontal layers, but because of tectonic forces, they get bent and folded and form these anticlines and synclines. This is the idea of original horizontality. Doesn't it make sense? Sounds fancy, but it just means originally the rocks are horizontal. That's how they start off. If we take a look at the diagram there, we have a bunch of sedimentary rock layers. Some have been folded, some have not. Deposition of rock layers A, B, C, D, E, and F is what happened first. Then there was some folding, and then G, H, and I. Original horizontality lets us know that that folding must have happened before G and H. Why weren't G and H folded? Well, they weren't folded because they weren't there to get folded at the time that A through F, layers A through F, were folded. G and H just weren't there. So if they weren't there to get folded, they must be younger. And that's this idea of original horizontality, that these sedimentary rock layers are deposited horizontally to begin with. Any folding must have happened after the deposition. Why weren't G and H folded? Because they weren't there. They must be younger. If we take a look at this diagram, we have rock layers G, F, E, D, C, H, and B, and A. We see that layers A and B have not been folded. Why? They weren't there. So the folding must be older than rock layers A and B. The folding must be younger than G, F, E, D, C, and H. Notice that we're now talking not only about the rock layers, but also about events and features that happen to the rock layers. That brings us to this next part. There's an intruder. Someone's intruding into your home. Isn't that ridiculous to think that they can intrude into your home before your home is built? You can't intrude into a building before the building is there. One of the things that intrudes our rocks is magma. You would imagine if there's some magma under the ground, that magma, which is going to be less dense, is going to start pushing its way through the rock. And as the magma pushes its way through the rock, it's going to intrude into those rock layers. And it might even burst out at the top and give us a volcano. Or maybe it doesn't at all. It just solidifies under the ground. It gives us a plutonic rock. Our fault. So here we could see if a fault or a line, a crack in the rock, this fault that you see right here must have happened after the rocks were there, right? That makes sense. You can see some similar layers. This layer right here is the same as this layer right here. Well, why aren't they lined up? Well, because there's been that fault there. We've got one side of the fault is moved this way, this side of the fault is moved that way, and it's faulted the rock. It's cracked through them. Well, of course, that fault can't happen until after the rocks are there. Here we see layers A, B, and C, and layers A, B, and C have been faulted. Well, the fault has to come after rock layers A, B, and C. The fault has to be younger than rock layers A, B, and C. It's the same thing with the intrusions as well. Here's an intrusion from the darker rock intruding into the lighter colored rock. That intrusion has to happen after. So here we see this rock is intruding. This was some magma, some melted rock that has pushed its way into another rock. Well, that magma has to be younger. We call this principle the principle of cross-cutting relations. And in both diagrams, you could see that layers A, B, C were either intruded or faulted, and layer D was not intruded on the left or faulted on the right. So layer D must be younger than the intrusion or the fault. Layers A, B, and C, in both cases, have to be older than the intrusion or the fault. There's an igneous intrusion down towards the bottom here. So here's this igneous intrusion. That's some magma. It's solid rock now, but it's solidified. It used to be magma that pushed its way through some other sedimentary rock. When that happens, when the magma touches the rock that it's intruding, it's going to burn that rock. I'm going to show that by putting some little tick marks on here to show that rock, when it got touched by magma, I would imagine if you got touched by magma too, you'd get burnt a little bit. It gets burnt there. And we talked about this concept when we talked about different types of metamorphism. How there's regional metamorphism, and the one that's being shown here is contact metamorphism. Here we see another intrusion. Some ignea, the dark igneous rock that intrudes into some sedimentary rock. And when it touches that sedimentary rock, it's going to cause some contact metamorphism. We could use this contact metamorphism, where the magma touches the surrounding rock, to help us identify the relative ages of some rocks. I know you don't have any room left on your page, but jump over to one of your blank pages, page 60 or 62, and let's get this idea of contact metamorphism and how it is going to help us figure out the age of some rocks. If you take a look at these two diagrams, they look very similar to one another, but there's something that's different about them. Can you find the thing that's different? The thing that's different about them is right here, we see that D has some tick marks on it, where over here, D does not. So on the left-hand diagram, limestone layer D does not have those little tick marks on them, which for us, those little tick marks are going to mean contact metamorphism. Those little tick marks right there mean there's been contact metamorphism. Well, why wasn't limestone layer D in the left-hand diagram, why wasn't that layer metamorphosed? Why didn't the magma burn rock layer D? Well, rock layer D is not burned, therefore it must be younger then because it came after the intrusion. Why wasn't it burned? It wasn't there to get burned. When the magma pushed through the shale A and the sandstone B, it burned those layers, but the limestone layer D wasn't there at that time. It must have come after, meaning it must be younger. Where in the right-hand diagram, D is burned. So if D is burned, it must have come before that. Layer D shows that it got metamorphosed. Well, the only reason it could have gotten burned is because it was there to get burning. So in the left-hand diagram, shale layer A was deposited, then sandstone layer B, then the igneous intrusion C came through, and then after that was the deposition of D. On the right-hand layer, deposition of shale A, then deposition of B, then deposition of D, and then the intrusion C came through and burned that. Here's a diagram that shows an outcrop where we see some rocks. We've got some shales and some limestone or rock salt. We see an igneous intrusion. The igneous intrusion is going to be this layer right here. This is the same igneous intrusion here, and the fault is that line there. Can you label these in order from oldest to youngest, meaning the first thing that happened, label number one, the last thing that happened, label six? Put them in order from oldest to youngest. So if we look at this, the first layer that happened was the shale layer at the bottom. Oldest rocks are at the bottom, so the first thing that happened is deposition of shale. The second thing that happened after that was deposition of the sandstone. After that was the deposition of the limestone. Those are pretty straightforward and simple. So the first thing that happened, the second thing, the third thing that happened there. You'll notice that the salt at the top does not get cut by the fault, and it does not get intruded either. That's the last thing that happened. It does not get cut. The salt layer at the top does not get cut by the fault. It does not get intruded. There's no contact metamorphism on it. That's the last thing that happens, number six. What we got to figure out now is which happened first, the igneous intrusion or the faulting. Notice that the intrusion gets cut. The intrusion was split. One part of the intrusion moved this way, one part of the intrusion moved that way. How did it get cut? Because it had to be there before the fault. The fault must have happened after in order to cut the intrusion. So the intrusion is going to be 4, then the faulting comes by in order to cut it as well as the other layers. Can you try another one? The depth is the formation of the gneiss, which is this layer right here. I'll start you off. That's the first thing that happened. Fill out the rest. As before, I've got a layer at the top that does not get cut, does not get faulted, does not get intruded. That limestone layer is the last thing that happened, so I'm going to label that right now as number 6. After my gneiss was formed, I have a sandstone layer that was deposited, so deposition of sandstone is the second thing that happened. And then I've got this layer here, the shale layer, and then I have this intrusion. Well, which one happened first? Notice how the shale layer has contact metamorphism. So the shale layer must have been there in order to get burnt. In order to get contact metamorphism, the shale layer must have been there previous. It's older then. And then again, I still have this issue with the faulting and the intrusions. Just like before, the intrusion gets faulted, so it must be there before the faulting.